All right, Steve.
Ew.
Woo-hoo! Steve and I go back to 1975?
Yeah, probably 1975, last century.
So, I don't know that I ever admitted this to you, but I have an admission to tell you. So, you know, my freshman year, I didn't have a car at college. And I found out Steve had a car, and kids and I just started hanging out around him so I could ride places.
Uber, that was Uber.
Oh yeah, that's right. But you know, we had some amazing times for sure. I remember the taco salad at Evangel College at their little, what was that? It was like a diner or something at Evangel.
We drive all the way over there.
So good, man.
Get the salad and maybe meet some girls.
Yeah. That was our job. That was our hobby.
18 years old.
That's right.
Yes.
So Steve is a senior pastor, and he is over three churches. There's the main church in Brunswick?
Middleburg Heights.
Actually. Middleburg Heights. The main church is in Middleburg Heights up by Cleveland.
And then
Brunswick and Akron are satellite churches. And Steve has been serving God, man. You were in our wedding. Yeah, Kim was just like, you were in our wedding. Yeah.
That's right.
He tried to find us, but you couldn't because we hid the night of our wedding. You guys tried to find us, but
oh,
we...
Oh, is that right? Yeah, I didn't remember that.
That reminds me. I think you and Kenny still owe me $20.
Yeah.
That was the last to get married.
I can't remember that at all. You owe me money for gas.
That's right. So, Steve, this weekend with the kids, we're talking about Elijah.
All right. And, love Elijah.
Man, I can't wait to talk to him in heaven. It's going to be an amazing conversation.
There's going to be a long line.
That long line waiting for Elijah. But, you know, he just had this great victory against the prophets of Baal. And he prays for the rain to start. And, he outraces the king's chariot and all that good stuff. But then...
Good day.
Do you remember what happened to him?
Yeah, a mean person said something that she was going to do to him to harm him, and it freaked him out. And he ran and hid.
He ran and hid.
Yeah.
And so that's the story we're talking about this week. And he got so low after that victory. It's just amazing to me that, it happens. Sometimes you get so high after a victory and something great happening. And the last thing you expect is to, boom, hit the bottom, and Elijah did.
It's like Sunday, Monday.
That's right. So, Steve, have you ever been so low that just like Elijah, you didn't really care to live anymore? You were just like, just take me out, God. I think I'm done.
Yeah, this morning I was kind of feeling, yes, I've had times like that. And depending on your age, I mean, when I was younger, it didn't take much for me to say, I'm done, I give up, this is terrible, one bad relationship or one bad grade of school or whatever it is. I mean, it seems like this is horrible, it's never going to change, I'm terrible. And then you get on all that self-talk and everything, you feel horrible. So I've been through all that. But then when you get older, you experience bigger challenges,
Right.
And if you're not ready for them, they can really be devastating. I was diagnosed with incurable cancer when I was 49 years old. And the good news is I'm 63 now. So,
yeah.
So that was 14 years ago. And, they said, you'll have this rest of your life. We'll try to treat it. They compared it to weed whacking. So we'll cut the weeds down, but they'll grow back. We'll cut the weeds down, but they'll grow back. That's the way cancer was. And I kind of got in the rhythm of that life. And then it really went crazy. So much so that I was falling down. I couldn't walk and everything. And, and they proposed a stem cell transplant. So they had to do a lot of medicine and everything, and I didn't feel well and all those kinds of things. But God gave me a dream in the midst of it. And it's, this is what I found, Jim, is that every time I've been a low spot, like the Bible says in Psalm 23, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'll fear no evil because he is with me. And yeah. I got to say this about God, regardless of what I've been through, challenges, finances, all these other things, God is always there. And but sometimes you have to still yourself. I was just looking at a verse this morning out of Psalm 46, be still and know that I am God. You know, sometimes we miss it because we're so busy, you know,
so busy,
and God calls us into that quiet place. And,
yep.
and so for Elijah, actually, it took him going to a cave, you know, where I'm sure it was pretty quiet in the cave.
For sure.
And he started getting some instruction from God at that point.
God said, hey, I'm not done with you.
Right.
I'm done with you. I got some stuff for you to do, but I want you to go out and stand in the entrance to the cave. Mm-hmm. And, so yeah, we tell that story with the kids, and it's just an amazing picture of, you know, God. I'm sure Elijah thought that the storm was going to, the God was going to be in the storm. Like, you know, that's just God. He's going to tear down the walls and he's going to do, but then he realized, nope, that wasn't God. And then, you know, he's still standing there. And then all of a sudden everything just dies down. Mm. He stills himself enough. The Bible says that he heard God in a whisper.
Ooh.
That is so, I love that. I love that God is speaking to us sometimes in whispers, but we got to calm ourselves down enough to know, you know, that that's him.
Yeah.
That's him. So how difficult is it for us to be still?
Well, you know, some people actually have a gift of being still.
I know.
You know, I mean, they're meditating people and they just want to go out and listen to the birds sing and watch the leaves change color, you know, and I envy that. I look at that and I think, I can't do that. I'm busy. I got stuff I need to do, you know. I love action. I'm a kinetic, moving person, you know. So you have to actually practice silence sometimes.
Yeah.
Sometimes you just got to still yourself. And, you know, I call it exploring your soul. So you're going exploring your soul. You've shut into yourself in order that you can understand how you tick, what you're about. Because the deal is somewhere in your life, you're going to be forced back. Like for me, when I had cancer and I was in a hospital, my world shrunk down to my bed. So, you know, there's not a lot of connection.
No.
It's just you and your bed. But it's sometimes, you know, I'm out there traveling around the world, 30 nations, preaching to people, all that stuff. all that action, boop, you're back in your bed.
Yeah.
And you're dying or you're very seriously ill or something like that.
Yeah.
But it's in that moment that whatever you've programmed into your spirit begins to come out in that moment. And if it's bad, it's bad. If it's good, it's good. Fortunately, there was some scripture that I'd put in my heart, and in the depths of when I couldn't even talk because my body was so sore, I couldn't even speak.
Wow.
Out of me came these verses, and the verse that came out of me was, the same spirit that raised Christ from the dead will quicken my mortal body. And that's when I was like, I lost 48 pounds. I was just a little skinny 130-pound guy, so, you know, 57-year-old guy at that time.
Wow.
Horrible. I mean, you see the bones of my body, the whole deal. I was just in bad shape. But in that moment, the Lord was with me. I was sleeping, Jim, sometimes 23 hours a day.
Holy mackerel.
And I, in the sleep, it was the, I, you know, I never had fear in the midst of it. Yeah. I mean, there's obviously moments where you go, oh my gosh, and what's going on? And how's this going to turn out? And will I ever see my grandkids and all these things, you know?
Yeah.
But what's amazing is the comfort of the Lord. You know where it says in the Bible, in Psalm 23, it says, surely goodness and mercy will follow me
absolutely
all the days of my life. And I'm telling you, he followed me. He was with me. And in that moment, and if you've been there, you know the voice of the Lord.
Yeah.
It's you know the voice of the enemy too. And you know the voice of, you know the that's voice right that's in your own head.
Yeah.
That says, oh, wow, you've blown it. You're being judged, whatever, you know.
Yep.
The voice of God, though, begins to lift you up. I mean, one word from God.
Yes.
And like shock your heart back into beating again.
I love that, man. It's like when the story of Elijah, when he was so down and he's,
oh yeah,
you know, he's sleeping and then he wakes up and he smells food cooking, and it's an angel. The Bible says that it was an angel that had cooked dinner for him, and had a jug of water. It was that was just like God when he spoke to you, but he was speaking to Elijah too. Hey, I'm still here. I love you. I'm not done with you. And that is an awesome, awesome thing to get from the Lord.
Well, you know what? I guess it is too that, you know, talk about still small voice. You can't get any more still than a dream.
Yeah.
Because a dream, you're in the dream. You didn't make up the dream. You didn't ask for the dream. You're sleeping.
Right.
But in the middle of that dream, God can speak. I mean, I could tell you, honestly, 30, 40 dreams in my life that some of those dreams actually healed me in my soul while I was sleeping.
Yeah.
And I woke up better. But the first dream, the big dream that when I was diagnosed with cancer, I had this dream and it was while we had a prophet, somebody who really hears amazing things from God, was visiting us. And I had this dream at night and I was singing. I had this English like sport jacket I was putting on, looking in a mirror. And I'm going, there's a nightingale in the house. There's a nightingale in the house. I'm singing this song. I don't know what it means. And I woke up singing, there's a nightingale in the house. And it actually woke my wife up. She goes, what are you doing? I said, I'm singing. She said, could you go sing in the other room?
I was asleep. I'm trying to sleep.
I knew it was God, but I thought, why nightingale? Why was I singing it? So I went down and I Googled it. You know, I Googled nightingale symbolism, Christian, you know, kind of thing. It pops up like 1,000 responses. And it said, ancient Christian omen of death. In other words, the nightingale means death. And I'm like, oh no, I'm going to die. I'm dying. The Lord's, he's giving me mercy by saying, you're going to die. I need to tell you, the nightingale's in the house. And I thought, get out of here, nightingale in the house. Why was I singing about it? So anyway, I'm disturbed. I couldn't go to sleep the rest of the night.
You know? I bet.
And so I go to the church service we're having the next day where this prophet was. And he was the kind of guy that was known that when he was around, people had dreams. I mean, I don't know what all that means. But anyway, I go in there and he says, how was your night? And I said, well, you know, I'm thinking, it wasn't very good, Bob. You know, and I said, well, I had a dream. He goes, oh, what was your dream? And I said, well, you know, I don't want to repeat this, you know. And I said, well, there's singing. I had this jacket on. I'm looking in a mirror. There's a nightingale in the house. There's a nightingale in the house. And I finished and he says, that's good. And I'm thinking, no, Bob, it's not good. I Googled it.
You didn't ask Google like I did.
It's bad. He goes, it's Florence Nightingale. She's the healer. And I thought, oh, Florence Nightingale.
That is.
And immediately my heart turned from I'm dying to I am living. I am living and I'm going to live a long time. Here I am 14 years later, you know, so the testimony is there. But God uses parables. He uses code. He uses mystery. He loves mystery. Yeah. And I'm sure Elijah didn't have all that figured out when he saw it. It wasn't like, oh, well, when are we going to get to the still small voice part?
Yeah, no.
I mean, he was being taught by the Lord right in the spot.
That's right. Ah, so good, man.
I love it.
Love it. I love it. I love it. I love it, man. I appreciate you coming on so much. Hey, one last thing. Would you just pray for the kids?
Kids. Absolutely. Yeah, Lord, we just bless them right now. I ask for the very power of the Holy Spirit to come upon them and their moms and dads if they're around. We just bless them right now. I pray, Lord, that households will feel the oil of the Holy Spirit like warm oil on their hands or upon their head, that your Spirit is upon them, that you've anointed them to preach the gospel to the poor, to open blind eyes, to heal the brokenhearted, Lord. We bless them right now. And during this pandemic time that we're going through, I ask for the peace of God that passes understanding, and that the God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet. We declare it right now. Victory is in your future. Victory may be in your past also, but it's coming in your future. And you look in your rearview mirror now, because surely goodness and mercy is following you all the days of your life. It's going to overtake you and overcome you. The goodness and the mercy of God is upon you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen, brother.
Amen.
Appreciate you, man.
Absolutely. Thanks. Good to see you.
Good to see you too.
All right.
We will talk to you later.
Thank you much.
Okay, buddy.
All right.